So welcome to our afternoon session. Our next speaker is Dmitry Kaledin of the Steklov Institute in the High School of Economics. You guys tell us about the structures in the future.
Thank you very much. There's been a change of schedule. We swapped with Sasha our talks. There's no formalism for this. Just a thought that conceptually it would make kind of a better narrative. I'm going to give something like an overview talk, and then Sasha will speak tomorrow about some more specific things. And on my own behalf, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me, for having all this here. It's a great pleasure for me. And what I'm going to present today is some kind of overview of material structure from community in Germany. And these are, of course, buzzwords which I have to explain. So there are two things to explain here. What do I mean by material structures? What do I mean by all kinds of cognitive geometry? And also, what has it got to do with the topic of the meeting, which is first here. So let me start with this part. Let's start with something familiar. So we have just some seen things manifold. We can consider its cohomology. There's some coefficients. Here, K is a coefficient ring, could be Z, Q, R, whatever. And then it has several equivalent solutions. So it's cohomology. Several. Well, there's homology and cohomology, there are two rules. So the first definition is where F doesn't even have to be manifold, it's just singular homology and cohomology. Basically, we think of homology classes as being represented by genuine geometric object cycles. So homology classes are genuine cycles. Next, closed subsets. Well, with the doubt of synthesis, for example, model natural notion equivalence, homological equivalence. Cohomology is by definition the dual. Another definition starts with cohomology. This also holds for any topological space, that can be manifold. And this is check cohomology. Here we use, we choose some kind of open covering. Choose it in such a way that these things and the intersections are sufficiently small. So all the sets of the covering and all the intersections are simply the contractor. And then we write down the check complex. Here coefficients can be anything, say Z for example. Here also the coefficients, and then just the ith term of the complex is by definition just the product over I call intersections. And then in principle I could write here cohomology of the intersections, but those are contractible, so this is just copies of K sort of numbered by corresponding to this intersection of the sets. And then there is a standard differential, and the whole thing computes something which I improved to be the same as what we get here. And there is a third version. This one doesn't need X to be manifold. It's interrupt homology. So here, X must be smooth manifold. Well, the coefficients now are not chosen, so the coefficients are prescribed. And the examples, coefficients are basically reals. And then the rank homology. By definition, computed by, so you consider a space of forms, bundles of forms, again with a differential. So these are vector bundles of X, so there is a form of sheaves, so there is a complex of sheaves, and X just take global functions. This is more restrictive, as I said, but for many applications more convenient. So there are other theory, I mean, there are other definitions of the same thing, but I think these three are kind of the major ones. But now let's do mental exercise. So let me not repeat the story, but with different contexts. So assume that now X is algebraic over some ring or field K, for example, over C. Question is, how much of this story can be said purely algebraic terms? Which can be said done purely algebraic? algebraic means like Carlos explained yesterday. Some closed subset in, say, projective space, distinguished by polynomial equations, not just arbitrary or small functions, but just polynomials. And then the answer is, so why ask this question? I think the original motivation of Grothendieck was to consider a situation where this K, the base field, is not C at all, but say a finite field. If you can do something algebraic, then conceivably you can do the same over some different field and then generalize the story in some settings where it doesn't exist. But even if you don't care about finite fields, you can just treat it as a purely mental exercise. I mean, how much of the story is algebraic and how much is necessary. And it turns out that all three stories have their counterparts, but now they give different things. So the answer is everything. But the answers are different. Different things. Okay, so I erased one, so let me reproduce number one. In some sense, this single homology story is the most natural one because it's completely intrinsic. I mean, we start with a manifold and we just geometrically think about things in this way. So we can try to imitate exactly the same here. So consider, again, basically cycles. But now these are not arbitrary closed subsets like a classical topology, but algebraic subsets. So things you can distinguish by polynomial equations. Algebraic cycles. Then there's a question of what is the natural notional equivalence between these things. And can experience show that a convenient thing to consider is so-called rational equivalence. Rational equivalence. Which basically means that if you have a map from some z times a, well, for example, it means if you have a map from some z times a projective line to X, then so some family of cycles can interact with projective lines, then fiber over zero should be the same as fiber over infinity. You have to work a little bit to make this 100% definition and to show that everything works and doesn't depend on choices, but in the end you end up with the so-called Chow groups. Chow groups. groups of algebraic cycles, model of rational groups. There is a version of the story, which is somehow more convenient than many applications. Version. It's called algebraic K-theory. The idea here is that, so what is a cycle form of speaking, when you want to define? Think about it, well, geometrically, set theoretically, a subset used by equations. Or equivalently, so if we have some x which is, say, we call it f', this is something which just corresponds to some commutative ring, and kind of the case graph and declination of algebraic geometry says that, tells us that varieties and rings are more or less the same thing. It's just one-to-one correspondence. And then you can glue varieties out of, I mean, varieties which are not affine out of affine ones, but this basic thing. And then in such a situation, a subvariety would correspond to an ideal here. Ideal in the ring. As I said, this is given by some equations. So we take all equations, we take all the functions which vanish on Z. And this is a one-to-one correspondence. But now, in many parts of algebras, it's well known, it starts from number theory, I suppose, that sometimes instead of just ideals, it is a reasonable thing to do to consider all modules, not just ideals. So if one allows A modules instead of ideals, then there is again a natural notion of dualness between them, and it gives what is known as algebraic K groups of X. I'm simplifying very much, but it's kind of right rough shape of the sort of thing. Geometrically, modules correspond to things like vector bundles on modules. In the end, it's almost the same meaning that there is a theorem which says that this thing has a certain natural filtration, such that the associated gradient fold proportion gives the Chow groups. So, slightly more than Chow groups, in fact, some high version of Chow groups. But in any case, there is this story, and this story is technically slightly more convenient. Now, this is absolutely great because it's really intrinsic. It uses no extraneous knowledge. We start with an algebraic variety and we do the most natural thing possible. The price to pay is that it's extremely hard to compute in all but most, the most trivial examples. So for projective space, you can compute it, and this should be one. But for elliptic curve, for example, this is a huge open question, which has, I think, $2 million price tag. It already becomes very, very complicated. So this is what we want to know, but it's very hard to use. Practical applications, there are also versions of this story. And this story, which gives things which are computed. Now, so let's turn to check.
Here we have a low arbitrary A modulus or projective A modulus?
I'm being kind of vague about it. Formally for K-theory, normally you take projective function generated. But if the thing is smooth, that makes no difference. You can take all function generated and it will give the same answer. It's important to have the function generated, otherwise you get zero.
I see.
So there should be some fineness condition, and then, yeah.
I see.
I feel better, but I'm really cutting like a lot of corners here. Right, so check your knowledge. So, first of all, what do we mean by, by open subsets? I mean, if you just work over an arbitrary field, the first thing you lose is classical topology. The idea is that for closed subsets, we use exactly this. So closed subsets are things given by polynomial equations. And then opens are just the complements to those, as usual. This is what is known as a Zariski topology on the X. It is very weak, but it's something defined purely algebraically. It's the most we can get. So here we right away have a problem, because here it was important that the open covering is by very small things which are contractive. But even if we are over C, but we only allow ourselves those algebraically defined opens, we cannot have, make them small. The problem cannot find the alpha that I contract. For example, if we have just a curve, complex curve, curve in the surface, this algebraic variety of dimension 1, and so the only closed operators are now of dimension 0, so it's just a finite number of points. So all possible opens here are of the form x without some points. And so this is a non-compact complex curve, and it's never contractible. In fact, this is a, if you look at the complex points of this guy, then this is a space of type kp1, with pi being a free group on n minus 1 generator. So the more points you remove, the bigger the group gets, and it's never contractible. However, what you can do, and it's easy to prove by thinking about this example, you can arrange for a cover of things which are next best thing in contractible, namely things which are of the type of k pi 1, so things which only have some kind of fundamental group, but no hypermodules. And that was Grafenstein's brilliant idea to solve the problem by generalizing the notion of an open coupling. So instead of subsets and coverings, one considers that is what is known as hypercoverings. Can consider hypercoverings. So roughly speaking, these are, so you have some u alpha, you have a map to x. This map is not injective, it's not an open beam. Not injective. But it's still an open map. And it is known as a time map in algebraic geometry. Roughly speaking, the idea is that you take some open subset and you take some covering of the subset. So a covering. Cover, this is a linguistic kind of ambiguity when the same word means two different things, and it was a great idea to realize that actually it is the same. Cover in the sense of algebraic topology. For example, you have C star, C without zero, right? And then you have like a twofold cover. It's hard to draw, but it's a map from C star to C star, which is just Z goes to Z square. It has two preimages over every point. Or it can be some higher power or some kind of more complicated thing, but and then you do things like that, and then you write again, write down. Check complex. So when you do the classical check complex, you can fix one open covering and do it for this. But equally well, you can consider all open covering and just take the limits. Take the smallest. Here, you cannot fix one single open cover. You really have to take the limits. But when you do that, you get a reasonable answer. This is known as a time. And that's good enough in the sense that when you actually are over C, so you can compare this to the classical topology, you get the same answer with one correction. It only works really well for finite coefficients, because in algebraic geometry, everything is finite. In particular, those coverings we have here they only have finite number of privileges, so you cannot really allow, like, for example, the universal covering of C star would be so there would be like Z preimages, every point would have Z preimages, but then this would be a map from C to star, which is the exponential map, and this is obviously not algebraic, so this we cannot do. So we get something called telecomology, and this is reasonable with finite coefficients. With finite coefficients. Coefficients. And one can slightly extrapolate from this. One can start to fix some prime L, consider like integers, consider coefficients Z modulo L to the power n for all n, and then do a compatible system of these things. So in the end, you can also push it a little bit to get coefficients to the n of qa. Yeah. So this is the real net combo.
Like for finite and integral finite.
Yeah. Again, cutting many corners. And now the Dirac story. No, n is arbitrary. Like 1, I mean, n modulo L square of cube and so on. Just go for the limit. And this also works. Again, the same restrictions as here. So it's algebraic manifold, so it must be smooth. There is a notion of smoothness. Algebraic geometry. The coefficients are again prescribed. It's the same as the base ring, base field of Euclid. And now, so here I just took global sections, just because when you have a C infinity manifold, as again we saw in Carl Stock, these sheaves typically have no cohomology. They are soft, whatever, don't have cohomology. Yeah. Here, in general, they do, so you have to take hypercohomology. And then it's a theorem, it's a non-trivial theorem again of Prof. Is that this a reasonable thing which gives the correct answer over C? This correct incorrect answer over C. Correct means the same as for classical topology. Now, this is a highly non-trivial statement because what I'm saying here, for example, if x is affine, then there is no cohomology, there are just global forms. And what is said, claimed here is that every cohomology class can be represented by a differential form with polynomial coefficients. First of all, holomorphic, and then with polynomial coefficients. Of course, there are much, much less polynomial functions than all functions.
Correct answer, you mean the natural map is isomorphic?
Yes. So there is a natural map, because I mean, you can consider all functions, not just polynomial ones. There is a tiny, tiny, tiny part of it. But still, it's enough to represent all cohomology. So for compact X, in this area that goes back to Serre's geometry algebraic analytic, the comparison between analytic and algebraic things, but then you also need to do it for, in this case, the affine case is actually more difficult. So the proof is by some technology, compactify, result singularity, and blah, blah, blah.
So you take just logarithmic. You take logarithmic, there are complex
plus holomorphic, and algebraic. Well, this predates, no, logarithmic is the second stage. You don't even need logarithmic. But the point is that you need to compactify, you need to resolve singularities to make sense of.
No, but logarithmic
complex
is sufficient for this, because you're
this. But I mean, so this is 1969, I think, okay. And logarithmic is maybe 2-3 years old. Mm-hmm. Slightly faster. Yeah. Anyway, so non trivial, but true. So this gives you a good thing. Now, so as I said, you get three different answers. But so this and this are different in a very obvious way. The coefficients are different, right? For example, if you are over C, then this gives you something over C, and this gives you something over analytic integers. You can choose L, but you can't, it has to be analytic because it goes to find coefficients. But the kind of thing number one in theory which is the intrinsic guy, which is the fundamental guy, the thing which should relate all the stories. There is a map from that to either of them. So the Chorn character map, so there are Chorn character maps. Let me ignore torsion for today, so let's just say so as usual in this business, I have some I here, then so Chorn character has many components, so it's more like the RAM or a time. But either of them is very far from being an isomorphism. Or not at all isomorphisms. And so we're interested in this guy. So to alleviate the situation, one wants to refine the right hand side. And the standard way to do it is as follows. One does, one tells that, so a priori these are just, you know, vector spaces, but in fact they carry more structures which you have to take account. And this is what is known as material structures. So typical shape of things is as follows. Typically, we have some category M, so it turns out the abelian category. And then we refine our cohomology theory to something which takes values in this case. So we have some kind of m-valued cohomology theory, which to any x associates a graded object here. We specifically consider projective line and its second cohomology. And we call it, so there are some coefficients, so this is over some ring k. We call it various reasons k minus 1. So this is a tensor category, and we require that this guy is invertible, meaning that there's respect to the tensor product. So there is also k of 1. Actually, the tensor product of this guy and this guy is just k.
K is abused here. K.
Abused. Abused. Sorry. I mean, there's only 26 letters in the alphabet, and we decided to use 3 of them. So. Yeah. And then one says that one defines excellent M cohomology of X as follows. One takes this thing. So it now has two indices. So there's the cohomological index, and then also the twist. And then this is, one takes, well, maybe let's not keep dot here, because so this is now an object in this category, but this category has its own homological algebra. So there are spaces of maps here, and X is possibly. And then one considers a home from K of minus J to move this guy in this category. And the point is that one usually can define this Chorn character to a map which takes radius here, and this has more chance of being, and this is expected to be close to isomorphism in many cases now. So typically you would have something like a map from K theory, let's say tensor K, which is not coefficients now, sum of H2 J minus I. Absolute. So for a delta voltage, well, you say that x is defined over some small k, and then as m you can consider the category. So this is a field which doesn't have to be algebraically closed. So it has some kind of algebraic closure. There is a Galois group, and then you can consider representations of the Galois group. And as part of the definition of the telcomology, it's easy to see that the telcomology is actually acts upon by this guy. So in that case, all the program is very straightforward. And the fact that this maps here is also very straightforward. But then again, the fact that this is close to the origin becomes wide open conjecture. Basically, state conjecture. Like if K is the finite field, then this small state conjecture about telcomology is probably true, but I mean completely wide open. And closer to our topic this week, for the Dirac story. Again, there are two versions, but kind of the standard version, Dirac story, and we're over, say, C. One imitates this pattern. Now, this M becomes the category of core structures. Category of, for simplicity, let me stick to R core structures. So the percentage
mixed.
So the precise definition has been given by Berlin Carlos, and they explained kind of a sketch of how this looks. But I don't want to give it a full definition either, but roughly speaking, what you have is, say, pure core structure of some weight. Pure. You have some R vector space. And then you can consider its complexification. And this guy is equipped with a decreasing filtration. And that satisfies some conditions. In terms of, so what this filtration is? In the examples which come from geometry, you have this Hodge-type decomposition. So this would be some cohomology group you write. You would have it as a sum over p plus q equal to weight for these guys. And then f I is the sum of the things where p is bigger than I. So it's a decreasing filtration. Now, the reason we use filtrations rather than gratings is that, as was explained by Delin, this filtration can be defined purely algebraically again. So this is something which can be defined completely within the algebraic world. And the transcendental part here is then this real vector space. So this is what is hard, and this is what requires analysis. But in any case, so there is this category. It has some very simple logical algebra. You can define this. This is known, I think, as absolute Hodge homology, maybe Hodge-Dirac homology. I mean, there's some name for it. There is a character map. And again, a hard conjecture says that it should be close to isomorphism to some degrees.
No, if you don't put Q.
No, even for R. If you put R here, even that should be. It's called Bilson conjecture. It's also called Hodge.
Maybe not for K0 or something. But it doesn't work for K0 in that case.
No, it doesn't work for K0.
Okay.
It definitely works for K2 and further. For K1 and K0, you have to make corrections. In fact, if you make the full corrections, this includes Hodge conjecture as part of it. But right away, K0 doesn't work.
But then you need two Hodge structures in that case.
No, you can even state something which would hold over R. It would not include the Hodge conjecture, but so there are versions. Which again, I don't really want to go into in much detail because all this is anyway conjecture.
No,
but
in Bilisco conjecture, X is of some number of fields.
Yeah. I mean, there are degrees of belief. I think most people don't believe in Hodge conjecture in full generality, but there is a chance that it holds when X is actually defined over some number field, not over some, just not over C, but over some kind of finite extension. Right, so there's the shape of things. Okay, so this was motivic structures. And I'm not going to tell you anything about how to prove anything, because I don't know. And so the fundamental general structure, right? Usual stuff. You can't prove something, you don't get genius. And the realization is somewhat, it's now standard, but has been somewhat unexpected. It goes into a direction which people definitely probably didn't expect. And what we change is the notion of X. As I said, at least a finite algebraic varieties are completely determined by the ring of function, so there's more or less equivalent languages. So X corresponds to A, and you can either state things geometrically or algebraically in real life. Okay, what if A is not commutative? A is not still associative unit, but not commutative. And observation number zero is that this thing is absolutely well defined. Because when I define K theory, I'm basically just dealing with modules over the ring A, say left modules. And exactly the same definition, no changes whatsoever, works for any associative ring. So this thing manifestly exists in much bigger, this much larger generality. But then, so there are, but as I said, this is not computable. So there are two other theories. There's a time cohomology and there's a drum type cohomology theories. And then it seems to be the case that the entire thing is hopelessly commutative, so that does not generalize at all. But everything which has to do with the RAM story indeed also makes sense of this generality. And this relies on an old theorem actually from the early 60s. Namely, there's a purely algebraic gadget, a homological gadget, defined for any rings, which becomes formed in the commutative case. And this is called Hodge homology. One remark though, if I said this. So I said that this is defined for any x, not necessarily. And this, in fact, this only depends well, on the category of Sheaven x, just by definition. But in fact, one can show that even more is true. If you're considering just the category of coherent shapes, one can consider the derived category of coherent shapes with some additional data which are known as an enhancement, some kind of. So it should be considered something called differential graded category. Or, in fact, and I don't really want to go into details as to how to define this and what this means exactly. But for example, you can have completely different varieties which have the same derived category. Another posterior theory is the same. This is called derived Marine environments of the story. And what is interesting is that you can also generalize things from a ring to a differential graded algebra. This is like a ring, but now it's graded as differential algebra. You you can combine the two stories, and then at some point you don't. So here we had affine varieties which corresponded to rings, but there are also varieties which are not affine, which are glued out of pieces. For non-convenient situation, there is no gluing. But it turns out that you don't need it, because in the end, one can show that every x, for every x, this category, which is the only important thing, is equivalent to the direct category of modules over some differential delta. So in this sense, in this non-commutative setting, every variety becomes affine, if you allow the geometry. All right. So what is the invariant now which gives you the ramp story? I will tell it for rings, but the story for DG algebra is exactly the same. You just add that another degree and just take it on a total object at some point. And for rings, this is something called quotient homology. So a short definition is as follows. So we're dealing with associative, not necessarily commutative rings. For our maybe algebras over K, over some base P, maybe flat over K. And if you have a non-commutative ring, you can consider left modules. To have one. Okay. Consider left modules, right modules, or pi modules. And if you consider A as a left module over the surface projective, as a right module over the surface projective, but as a pi module, it's certainly not projective, not even flat, I mean, that's not real logical algebra. And so you do exactly this. You consider A as a pi module over itself, or equivalently a module over A opposite. Times A. A opposite is A where the product is written in the other order. And now it has a trivial homological algebra, so we can consider it the higher order functors, derived functors of the product. And this is by definition quotient homology. In practice, you can write down an explicit complex, functorial complex, which computes it. It's rather large, so it's not very useful practical applications, but it's completely universal for tutorial. And its terms are just tensor powers of A as a vector space. A square, a cube, and so on. There is a simple differential which is usually denoted by small b. For example, this here, this thing here, is basically just a commutator map. And high degrees there will be formulas with more terms, doesn't really matter what they are now. Something which is not defined. And kind of the main theory which gives rise to the whole subject. Is the theorem of quotient Kostner-Troisenberg. Says that assume that we're in the commutative situation. A commutative. So we can consider the corresponding variety. And we want this to be smooth over K. In particular, this means that this ring is finitely generated. So this general algebraic variety will use more or smooth. Then if it, since it's smooth, we can consider the tangent shift, cotangent shift, and differential forms. And now the claim is that there exists a factorial isomorphism between ith quotient homology groups and the spaces of differential forms of degree I. This works over any weight. This k can be unary, can be filled with Boyse characteristic. This is a funny theory because when I first learned this, I thought, okay, people were comparison of Hodge and homology, and they came up with a nice answer. But turns out that no, if you look at the paper, they were deliberately trying to understand the reason for existence of differential forms. Because if you're an algebraist, it's a totally not obvious way to consider differential forms. I mean, they take exterior powers of omega 1, where exterior is not symmetric. I mean, well, it seems like an arbitrary thing. And this gives some kind of explanation of why this is exactly what you want. Because this thing is obviously very general, very general. And then it gives you exactly this and nothing else. And then, of course, the second question is around differential, because it's okay to have forms, but then it's not much use for geometry, you don't want to know differential. And here, there's a sort of second story. Great discovery, which says that, again, the Dirac differential exists in full generality. So, moreover, so let me denote this by CH of H. It stands for Hodge's homework. So there is a factorial map which looks, which is actually a map of complexes from this guy to itself with a shift. So it's known as, it was discovered simultaneously and independently by Alan Cron and Boris Zeigler. So it's sometimes called Zeigler differential. In fact, it was discovered by somebody, by Steklov, by the name of George Reinhardt. Not completely forgotten. So it was discovered in the early 80s by these two people, and then it gave rise to the whole story. So this squares to zero. Then, if you look at this situation, so in the HKR situation, this isomorphism star sends the Dirac differential. And moreover, you can now use this guy to write down something which would approximate the Dirac homology. Namely, consider the following thing. So, you basically want to make a bicomplex where in one direction would have CH and then it would be capital G, but you have to repeat it many times. So it's, in fact, one copy of CH over A is not enough, you have to have an infinite number of copies. So formally, let me do it like this. I take this guy and I repeat many times its shift. So I write it as form of Laurent polynomials in one formal variable U of degree 2. But the differential I want to put here intertwines small and capital B. So it's small b plus capital B times B. And because the degrees are, the degree shifted by minus 1, not plus 1, this total differential has the correct degree, so it has certain complex. Again, factorial with respect to A. And then it's homology by definition. You know that HPA homology of this complex is known as the periodic cyclic homology of A. And then the comparison theorem says that in the situation of Hodge-Strasberg theorem, situation. And moreover, under the assumption that we are not requesting characteristics, no, I have to assume that K contains Q. We have an isomorphism, a notification between HP of A and just the Dirac homology of X. But again, not a single copy of it, but you have to repeat it many times. It's a kind of periodized version. And in this sense, periodic cyclic homology generalizes to a full one community situation the Dirac homology which we know. You can ask what happens if K is like a fine field, and the answer is we don't know, even now. Well, I mean, if, say, if dimension of X is smaller than the characteristic of the field, then the same is true, but in general, at least if we are only interested in characteristic zero, then we know. And now the expectation is now that, so this is well established, and the expectation is that this has all the material structures that the Dirac homology is known to have. So expectation HP of A carries all the material structures of H term. Now, if we're over C,
what are the assumptions on A?
Expectation, right? I don't know. No, but realistically speaking, so first of all, it should be for DG algebra, right?
Yeah.
The definition is the same. You just do the same. There's one more direction. Realistically, we should expect so there is a notion of smooth proper integer algebras which correspond to smooth proper algebraic varieties. So this has any chance to be, this has a good chance of being true for smooth proper integers.
Almost 100%.
Yes, but it's still wide open. Right? But there is a periodic version which I hope to have like 5 minutes in the end. And that exists in bigger generality. That exists in Fourier. So the jury is out. So if K is equal to C, then this structure is not, we know what the structure is, it's the Hodge structure. Maybe R Hodge structure, Q Hodge structure, I mean that. But it consists in two parts. It consists of the filtration and this kind of complex conjugation action in case of Hodge structure, or Q lattice. But the point is that the first part, as I said, is a purely algebraic thing, as explained by Deligne. Basically, so the filtration on H Dirac is induced by the filtration of the Dirac complex, and this is the so-called stupid filtration. So Dirac complex is just some complex, and then you do the following. So there is omega I, omega I plus 1, and so on. So starting from I is Dirac complex, and here you just stupidly put zeros. This gives a decrease in filtration of the complex, and this induces the filtration, correct filtration topology. And so this story is pure algebraic, there is nothing difficult about it, and it carries over to this world directly. Because by definition, this CP is basically a bicomplex. So there is stupid filtration in one of the directions, this gives you a filtration. And so F is known. But the big open question is the Q or R lattice, because a priori, if we're over C, this is just some kind of complex vector spaces. And why on earth it has a complex conjugation, why on earth it comes from something defined over R, even, let alone Q, is absolutely unknown. So complex conjugation is a big mystery.
No, but there is conjecture, and less conjecture.
Yeah, I don't want to go. There is a conjecture explanation, but first of all, it's not useful because it reduces the problem to the commutative case. And second, it's also wide open. So. But let me finish by explaining one ray of hope in this whole situation and one reason to think that this non-commutative generalization is not a stupid thing to do. So, as I said, there is the story for Dirac homology where you have some QL coefficients. There is a story for Dirac homology, which over C gives you a question. But there is another story about Dirac homology. Namely, what if K is adiabatic integers? In this case, you can also consider Dirac homology. And you can ask whether it has any, what is the correct material extraction in this case. And we kind of know. So the situation is like this. You have some x. The algebraic geometry, I mean, being over k means that there is a map to the spectrum of z. Here, there is a special point which responds to the finite field. And we can consider the fiber of this point. Algebraically, this means that we take a ring and we just reduce the modulus p. It's a ring of helix, we just take a point. This is small, so this is small. And then, again, it was average. We go back to Grothendieck. So in this case, it was again like late 60s. So you can ask, so we have the Dirac homology of x. And it turns out that it can be recovered purely from x0. No, there is something called crystalline homology. Theory for, well, arbitrary, but in particular smooth algebraic varieties over, say, FP or over a finite field. And there is a comparison theory which says that when your x0 comes from some x, there is a canonical isomorphic difference. So this Dirac homology x does not depend on x, in fact. It only depends on x0. First of all, it's well defined. Well, there is no x, because there are varieties over a finite field which cannot be lifted. If they can be lifted, they can be lifted in different ways. But this is independent. But the third thing, if there are sometimes, even if you can lift a variety, maybe there are some automorphisms of x0 which do not lift automorphism of x. But since they act here and then. And there is one thing which every variety over a finite field has, and this is the Frobenius map. So there's always a Frobenius map from x0 to itself, which is defined as follows. So,
if x is not proper, you need the basic completion of the Dirac homology of x over z. So this is the inverse limit of the Dirac homology.
Yeah.
But if
it's probably the same as basic completes.
No, if x is not proper, it's
five lines. You need to take
yes.
Yeah. I'm saying that this is not more than that, so it's probably like PIAT yeah. So there is always this Frobenius isomorphism. And in algebraic geometry, a map is not just a map of points. It's a map. A map should do something to points and then do something to functions. And this map does nothing to points, but every function is raised to the nth power. And because of the positive characteristic, this is actually an additive map. This is really a ring map. So this is a genuine map of 0 to 0. Even if x0 lifts to x, this map very rarely lifts to the non-prism of x. But by virtue of this thing, the Dirac homology we lift carries a natural action of the Frobenius. So we have the Dirac homology of x, isomorphic to crystalline homology of x0. Here we have the action of this Frobenius. And here, since it's Dirac homology, we have this Hodge filtration, increasing Hodge filtration. And the interaction between the two gives you this material structure, which is relevant in this case. Now, I can be more precise, but I don't want to, because I don't think the final word is known yet, so we don't really know the final condition. But some kind of interaction between the two is what we need. And now the upshot is that, so it's a theorem of, so the upshot is that this thing at least exists in formal computer generality. And there are several approaches. So there is sitting unpublished, and maybe unfinished. There's some work of mine, but that's not important. There's a very recent work of Vadim Vologodsky and Sasha Petrov at Harvard now. So there is a factorial crystalline version of periodic cycle homology of DG algebras for DG algebras over finite field, say P of Q, which has all the properties. In particular, it has this Frobenius method. This is weird because A itself does not have Frobenius map anymore, because this only becomes a ring map if you're on the community situation. However, it's actual homology collapse. Okay, I don't really want to go over time, and this ain't in any way work in progress. Just two words about the general idea. The idea is that, okay, you do the lifting, but then, as we saw in Carl's talk today, one of the main properties of cohomology is that it's actually stable, it's locally constant in families. So you can think about this in differential geometric terms or algebraic terms. In algebraic terms, there is something called the Gauss-Monin connection on the Ramp cohomology, which shows that it's locally constant, at least in finitesimal gradient families. It works in any characteristic. And it works also for HP. So this non-community generalization, there is a version of Gauss-Monin connection discovered by Gessler a long time ago. So they use this. The problem is that in characteristic P, a flat connection is not the same thing as trivialization. Because usually to trivialize something, you write down the exponential map, and that has denominators. So it's not true that you have something with flat connection, and all the fibers are the same. But if you have something over ZP or T, with a flat connection. So some module over this guy. And if you can consider the fibers over different values of T, say over 0 and over 1. And there is no way to compare V0 and V1 because it would require some kind of exponentiation, it would converge. But if you only want the fiber over the point P, then you're okay. Things converge. So this is canonical isomorphic to P.
If P is greater than
2
or
4? And this helps sort of, they do this lifting, this is the main reason why the construction works. So at least there is a glimmer of hope here. And the procedure is completely non-commutative. You don't reduce to the commutative situation. It's actually simpler than the commutative. Even here, there are many unanswered questions. For example, this is a story over ZP, not about QP, right? It doesn't depend on the choice of the ZP model, we don't know, and many other questions. But this, there is some hope, and I expect that there will be some progress in the near future about this. Okay, I think this is the case we don't want to do.
Let's have coffee.